for a number of startups that have gone on to raise significant funding and global protection. And recently with the award-winning AirTeam wireless HDMI streaming device that became the most publicly backed crowdfunded project in Europe on Indiegogo at all time. Jim has more than a decade of entrepreneurial experience working with startup and corporations like Samsung, public organizations such as the SAIT Business School at Oxford University and the Kauffman Foundation to Development, Innovation and Strategy Workshop, as well as lecture on entrepreneurial techniques with a focus on lean methodologies and global connection. And next to James is my friend from the same organization, ICSB, International Council for Small Business. Dr. Atef Elshabrawy has over 25 years of experience in M and SMEs, Islamic banking and entrepreneurship. He is ex-CEO and founder of Family Bank, the first micro and SME Islamic bank in Bahrain. He was awarded the Mohammed bin Rashid Award for the best SME bank in Arab world by His Excellency Mohammed bin Rashid, ruler of Dubai at the World Entrepreneurship Forum in 2013. Dr. Atef occupied several senior positions such as advisor to the Bahraini government, general manager at the Bahrain Development Bank, director at the Social Fund for Development, lecturer in Tabin Institute in Egypt, researcher at Ineris Institute National de Environnement, too sophisticated in France. He also served as an expert in ECI, ILO, IFC, World Bank, ISESCO, and blah, 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 blah. And the most important is member of ICSB.
Yeah.
He is my friend in ICSB because I'm the president of International Council for Small Business Indonesian Chapter, and I was just elected as the president also of Asia Council for Small Business in New York last month. He's an international speaker, consultant, and instructor on M and SMEs Islamic banking, providing his services for Islamic banks worldwide. He has led the conversion of several conventional banks to Islamic banking and recently founded the Social Innovation Expert Organization. Dr. Atef has a PhD from France, DEA from France also, and BSc from Cairo University, Egypt. He has published 35 articles and 3 books on the development and renaissance of the Islamic world, SMEs, Islamic banking, and business incubation. My other friend, Indonesian panelist, Sandiaga Uno, is still on the way coming here.
Let me guess, Indonesian traffic?
I'm sorry? Yeah, this is Jakarta. Yeah. Okay, this is your first time to come to Jakarta.
Yes, it is.
Okay, James, 3 minutes for you. Please talk about the topic. 3 minutes?
Certainly. 3 minutes to talk about the topic. That's a very interesting part. You know, so for me, looking at microfinancing, I'm not from here, obviously, as you can hear, as you probably see. And I tried to take an international perspective on how to look at the microfinancing industry here in Indonesia. And the way for it for me was to see how can we look to develop entrepreneurial talent within microfinancing. It's not just about having the elements of just having the process of giving out this money. How do you also then ensure that the money is being used well and then being used to further develop not only themselves, their family, but also the communities that surround them as well? So how best does that fit in, and what are the things that we could look at and discuss today that could potentially be that process moving forward?
Okay, that's it?
That's it. I mean, that's nice and easy.
Okay, good. Good. Shorter, the better.
Yes.
The shorter, the better. Yeah? Atef?
Yeah, great. Thanks for coming for the session. In fact, I prepared a presentation, but I'll go through a very short. My word will be very simple. In fact, I'll just mention that we are living in a changing world. So we will have 4 changes if we talk about the upgrading the micro enterprise in Indonesia or in the world. I will just summarize by saying that first, we are living in a changing world. Actually, if we have this conference, 10 years back, we didn't have a digital economy, we didn't have Uber, we didn't have crowdfunding, we didn't have platform. So first the change we have to endorse in our mindset that we are living a changing world. So micro-enterprise of today is different than micro-enterprise of yesterday. The second, that micro-enterprises are facing a different clientele and customers. The customers of today are different than 10, 20 years back. They are more, let's say they are more aware by the, they have more choices, they have social media, they have different ways of identifying and selecting and taking the proper price, proper quality, and they are different than the customer of yesterday. So the mind of micro-enterprise have to think about it. The third element that we have plenty of enterprises. Actually, we have the World Bank last year issued a report mentioning that we have about 500 million micro and small enterprises worldwide. We have every single second, 8 businesses is created in the world, actually. So we have a huge, tremendous wave tsunami of enterprises are creating. So we are having that kind of wave, which is supported by the third point, which is a creation of ecosystem. I can congratulate Mr. Taneri, who presented earlier that Boomara, the concept of having a full-fledged support. Actually, the governments worldwide are facing a tremendous pressure, either from the unemployment or for the economic development and growth, which everyone wants to have a higher growth. So the governments worldwide are looking for SMEs as a promoter for that kind of changing the life of people. So we have a tremendous number of ecosystem. If you go to any country, actually, you will find the term ecosystem that all everyone is working, banks working with university, with collateral funding, with the governments to give incentive and that. And the last point will be the mindset of micro-enterprise. If you look for the micro-enterprise of today, we have more, we have a changing stereotype. The guy or the girl who is establishing a micro-enterprise today are totally different from that 20 years back or 15 years back. They are most of time educated. They have accessibility to social media, to media in general. They are more quality-oriented. They are more creative and more innovative. So the last point, which we come with the stereotype of the owner of enterprise, is a presence and a huge tsunami of the social media. You know, if we talk about any micro enterprise today who doesn't have a presence in Instagram or Facebook or Twitter or whatever, we consider him someone who's already left the wave. So we say that the world again is facing a tremendous change, which is I summarize it by the four points, that the social change, which we are already changing, our requirement, our expectation from the business is changing. We have actually in Europe about 33 million self-employment, so global move of people who are leaving full-time job to work in Uber and all the platforms, which is, again, some of them are considered to be micro-enterprise. So just to start saying that micro-enterprise became one of the motor of the engine of economic growth, one of the engine of democratization, because anyone can be an owner of enterprise, anyone can change his life, and the most dangerous dimension, that the technology dimension, and the globalization. So actually we have an internationalization of micro-enterprise. I can mention to you many micro-enterprise who become multi-dimension, by the fact that, you know, my next neighbor, he's a micro-enterprise, but he has a presence in 25 countries. So it is a multinational micro-enterprise. So all what I'm willing to say that the global change will change totally the picture of micro-enterprise. So the governments, when they are thinking to help them, we have to step back and to understand the social change first. And later we decide what are the mechanisms, what are the chemistry which we will generate in the country to ensure that our micro-enterprise in Indonesia is a global, multinational, top to the point which can compete and grow.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Atef. So let's go back to the topic, upgrading Indonesia micro-business in market access and funding, right? And we are lucky to have both of you, non-Indonesian, maybe you can share your experience, right, for Indonesian. In the last almost 2 years, Now I become like a special advisor to the Minister of Small Medium Enterprise and Cooperative, and I learn about small medium enterprise in Indonesia. And so many micro enterprises in Indonesia, they always ask funding, funding, funding. I don't have money, I need money. I can produce anything you want, but I don't have money. But at the end of the day, we found out, but not only money. Yeah, the government here, our president is very good, reducing the interest rate from 23% to 9%, and probably next year will be 7%, still relatively high compared to international market, but it's actually, it's very, very good already, the support of the government in funding. But if they don't really understand marketing, basically I'm a marketing guy, and marketing is not only about promotion, marketing is not about selling, so many misunderstanding about marketing, right? But marketing to me is how you try to find the segment that you want to target.
Yeah.
If you don't know the segment, you just produce, 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 and then you have money, even the interest is so low, finally you cannot get market access because you don't have the clear target market, and then you don't produce the right product for the right target market. So from both of you's experience, how will you be able to help your client or startup or whatever you want to mention it? How to teach them with the good marketing practices?
I think that you touched upon it very quickly. You know, marketing isn't just about, you know, putting an advert out anymore. It's also about finding about your customers and knowing who you want to sell to and what your product's for and why they really want to have it. And I think the important thing becomes is actually educating these entrepreneurs, whether they be in microfinancing. Just the term microfinancing actually surprised me, is that microfinancing is for a company that is under $2 million in revenue, which is the majority of companies out there. Typically, then you look at family-run businesses that support for themselves and not much more. So then how best do you give them this information, this knowledge of the markets and access to different variations?
You have your real experience in helping your client start up to find out the right segment for them?
Certainly. So I work in a lot of technology startups, and with that I implement a lot of lean methodologies. And lean is a system that means that you don't go ahead and build a full product from day one. But what you do is that you develop small parts of the product, you go out there, you get them the idea validated. People talk a lot about the MVP, minimum viable product. I want to take that to the next level and actually say, we want people to find the MLP, the minimum lovable product.
Okay.
Where do people really enjoy using your service, enjoy using your product?
Wow.
And it's at that point, then you can go out and start remarketing to other people and saying, you know, these people really love it. We think you can love it too, and here's the reasons why. But without understanding why the product is loved, it's very difficult to go out there and sell that in the first place.
Okay, now you're becoming expert in marketing. Eh? Wow. And you mentioned earlier when I met you personally that you know Gojek in Indonesia. Eh?
Yes.
Gojek is special, very unique Indonesian concept. What is your comment?
Certainly. So Gojek last night won the best startup of Indonesia. And you know what amazes me is I was speaking to some of the founding team and the way that they kind of went about, and in the CEO and the founder's remit was he just wanted to help people. He wanted to go out there and see how can he impact other people's lives.
And that is marketing, eh?
That's marketing. He went out there and he went out to the drivers and said, what do you want? What do you feel is needed to help you? To help you deliver better service, a better product, and what can I do to help you?
So if you have the right marketing, so funding is not so difficult. Is that right?
Atef? Yeah, I feel Joining the speech in the talk during the last the session before about the banking and being a banker for 18 years, I mean, I would like to put aside the question of not having money in the banks, because banks are there to provide money. So the issue is actually is if you start a business in 2016, you should think global. I mean, if I'm supporting, I actually supported, for example, 4 years back, a Filipino lady who is actually in Manila, and she has a small website, and she's selling gifts for Filipino expats who are all over the world. And she's making tremendous amount of profit. All her job is just to connect local handicraft in Manila and some places, and just a website. It is based website, and she might be a millionaire actually. So if you start a micro enterprise and you don't think global, you don't think about technology. So I respect the whole theories of marketing, which is actually we are learning plenty of things from the traditional marketing, but digital marketing come up with a total change of the picture, where every single business in the world has an opportunity to be global. No one will prevent you to sell. You are an Indonesian based, but no one will prevent you to sell in the States. If you have, for example, a food kind of regulatory framework, you have to respect it, but beyond that, you don't have any problem. The major drawback of the, or let's say the failure of a small business worldwide is the managerial skills. And managerial skills, someone of the audience mentioned it properly, that the character of the entrepreneur, okay, whatever money we provide, whatever the support, I always being attacked as a banker in all the speech that, okay, we don't give money for startups or SMEs, but no one is attacking university, for example. University is not elaborating a proper educational system. I'll give you one example. Look for Harvard. Harvard has, the graduates of Harvard are creating 35,000 enterprises. The total turnover of students of Harvard, the businesses created by the students, is $1.2 trillion. So imagine one university is proposing an environment. So the guy who is getting out from Harvard comes to our bank. We don't have a difficulty to deal with a guy who knows what he wants and he has all in mind. So from point of view of having a proper marketing strategy, you start by having a proper education where you can identify opportunity. Come to point of my colleague, actually we use business model canvas. I understand that people consider business model canvas, which is modeling the business, is for bigger business or even for medium. But if you don't know the value proposition, if you create a business and you don't know what is the client is looking for, what is exactly you will provide the client to be able, he will be buying from you, staying loyal, and buying again and again, and talking about your business in good say, so your business will grow. So that guy will never grow, will never succeed. Okay. So the question of marketing comes, I mean, a later stage when you start by a strata of preparation and education, preparation of mindset that, okay, you have to be global, you have to think in new tools, you have to think in a ways which enable you okay. to be global.
Okay, thank you, Atef. Now, while waiting for Pak Sandiaga
Udo,
so maybe some question from the floors, please. The floors is open for you. 1, 2, 3. Or
do you have a microphone?
I saw some friends from Chamber of Commerce of Indonesia. At least please give comment from Chamber of Commerce of Indonesia to the two foreigner panelists. Anybody from, anyone from Chamber of Commerce of Indonesia, Kadin Indonesia?
Is that a lady from Indonesia? Maybe.
No, no one? Yeah, Ibu. Are you from Chamber of Commerce? Yeah, silakan. Are you Indonesian, Ibu? Yes, please. Please give comment and maybe you can ask something. Make our discussion becoming more relevant to the topic. Yes. Upgrading Indonesian micro business in market access and funding.
Yeah.
Please.
Thank you very much, Mr. Yes. Hermawan. I'm Ida. I'm a chairperson of Indonesian Business Women Association from South Sulawesi. Our members, 99.8% are SMEs micro.
IWAPI.
Yes, IWAPI. Yes. having access to funding in Indonesia now for micro players is no longer a problem.
Kur, yeah?
Yeah.
9%.
We have all the banking institutions, finance institutions, all access to the micro players. The
not SMEs. An issue anymore. Eh? Funding is not an issue
for
anymore.
Us, it's not an issue anymore.
Okay.
The issues are, especially for the young entrepreneurs, the startups, is what Atef actually just mentioned, very, very truthful for, especially for Indonesian cases, is the education. If you look at the points, I don't know in English, but for Indonesian, we call it SKS.
Education in?
In Indonesia.
In what? You mentioned the problem. Money is not the problem, but the problem is in education. Education in what? In entrepreneurship or in marketing or in what?
In all faculties, it needs to be, we have to have a lot of entrepreneurs program included in whatever faculties, because whatever happens after they graduated, these young graduates, they're facing a lot of challenges in terms of creating businesses. Mm-hmm. So I think for Indonesia, the big challenge is how to reshape, redesign, restructure our education program.
Mindset.
Yeah, the mindset. Thank you very much.
So don't only dream to be a civil servant, right?
Yeah.
So not job seeker. To be an entrepreneur.
Yeah.
And we have Pak Ciputra, actually. Ciputra is our father of modern entrepreneurship in Indonesia. Yeah. He is a property tycoon, but he is a motivator. Mm. Always pushing to everyone that Indonesia must have at least 2% of the population are entrepreneurs. And he set up a university of Ciputra.
Ciputra in Surabaya.
Not only in Surabaya, in Jakarta. Okay. And I just met him 2 months ago, and I asked him to be honorary advisor of ICSB Indonesia, and he's happy to accept that position. And he told me in universities of Ciputra, whether you are student of engineering or you are student of economics or student of law or whatever, you must learn entrepreneurship.
That's right.
What is your comment about that?
I wholly agree. It's not just about learning entrepreneurship within a business context. If you go to the business school, you have to go through these particular elements. I think entrepreneurship is also a way of looking at things, a way of looking at a problem and seeing how can you solve that? Do you have that pain yourself? And then how do you go out and do that? And it teaches you a tool set that you can apply to different values that then can move forward as well. So whether it's in economics or whether it's in finance or whether it's in mechanics or whatever, I think it's just you have to have this kind of mindset built in from the very, very bottom level. So take, for example, in Estonia and in Denmark, we've started teaching coding in kids from as young as 4. What that has now is teaching that element of how do we build in the science and the education and the technology, but also in a framework that means how do I solve these problems at a very early age. Then that will allow you to have that kind of entrepreneurial mindset moving forward.
Yeah.
Yes. I know Kauffman Foundation, right? Yeah. Kauffman Foundation. And Universitas Ciputra is collaborating with Kauffman Foundation. And now president of USASB, our friend, United States of America Small Business Enterprise. He is in the he's a fellow of Kauffman Foundation, and he knows Pak Ciputra from Indonesia. So entrepreneurs is made or born?
Yeah, the question entrepreneurs is made or born, the big debate worldwide. In fact, we find that, we don't have an answer, but they are not born and they are made. They are kind of exposed to certain conditions which are getting out of them the entrepreneurial mind. But just I have a reply to our colleague from Indonesia. You know, actually, the Higher Council of Education in the States issued what they call it entrepreneurial university. And actually, in Bahrain, I have we are supporting two private universities, to transform the university into entrepreneurial. It's not to have an entrepreneurship course or non-incubator. It is a total mindset. I mean, we started by gathering the whole professor. In fact, we have the professor of university, all professor. I have one figure just to show you. 85% of graduates of pharmaceutical faculties in the Middle East are working in pharmacies, okay? But we don't teach them how to manage pharmacy. Okay, they are just delivering the medicine, but no one told, you know, what is the problem if we give them a small entrepreneurship course within the faculty of pharmaceutical just to be in case they will create a business. But comes to the entrepreneurial university, we have actually even the European Commission edit a definition, which is 12 points. So you have to be incorporated 100% entrepreneurship in all courses. You have to ensure that all professors are getting kind of knowledge in entrepreneurship. And you end by getting incubator or entrepreneurship development center. Our perception of entrepreneurial university, that university who has kind of activity, but now we have a benchmark. As you mentioned, the Kauffman Foundation might present kind of education for certain desired people who are desiring to go for entrepreneurship. But what about the others? Your good question that they are born or made. If you look, the lady, the owner of Body Shop, we know all the Body Shop.
Anita Roddick.
Yeah,
Anita Roddick.
Anita, the founder. Anita, she was a lady who her husband left her in 1978, and she had kids, and she had to earn her life. So she created a small cosmetic handmade business, and now she's the most wealthy lady in UK. For example, Anita, she started from nothing. She doesn't have any skills to be entrepreneurial. So we can't have a theory who is an entrepreneur and who is not, but we say the exposure. Plus, according to what we have, a global competition of 500 million business, so we have to have certain skills, and that kind of skills enhancement, you have to go through education, training, whatever. But, I mean, we can't exclude that any one of the audience today might be influenced by what we are saying and perhaps thinking about it.
Okay.
You know?
But if I can just add to that very quickly, it's just, you know, born or made, and you mentioned Anita, she didn't have the actual training, but I believe it's actually a mindset thing more than anything else, and it's actually teaching that mindset as opposed to those actual skills of, you know, you must do this in marketing, you must do this in economics, this is what it, and if you do these things, you are an entrepreneur.
Yeah.
No, you must think like this, you must do it this way, then you're an entrepreneur.
I'm very lucky to meet Anita Roddick personally before she passed away. Oh. By coincidence, I had lunch with her only and Deepak Chopra.
Yeah.
Are you familiar with Deepak Chopra?
Chopra, yeah.
From India.
Yeah.
And in Singapore, only three of us having lunch. The best lunch in my life.
Yeah.
And then she told me, Hermawan, I know you have been working with Philip Kotler for 18 years, blah, 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 but marketing is bullshit. Because marketing is cheating people. Good advertisement, but no reality. And I don't need funding, actually. When I started Body Shop, it is a necessity. Yeah. Not because I'm an entrepreneur, because I don't have money. I was very poor at that time. Yeah. That's why I must start a business. And then, why I started with a refill system?
Yeah. Yeah.
Because I don't have money.
She created it.
To follow the other brand, that which is where packaging is very important.
Mm-hmm.
But now, I'm on track. Yeah. People respect me. Absolutely. Nah, so sometime entrepreneurship happened by coincidence.
Mm-hmm.
In Boston, they have Harvard Business School.
Yeah.
But next to Harvard Business School, in the same city, they have Babson College, you know?
Yeah,
and Babson is always very proud. We are not business school, we are entrepreneurial school. You know, Indonesia have a social house here, a restaurant, graduated from Babson.
Okay.
And I'm proud as an Indonesian. In Dubai Mall, we have social house.
Yeah.
Yeah, the only Indonesian branded restaurant in Dubai Mall. Can you imagine? Okay. Not so many.
Very
not so many. It's very rare. So, Nadil Makarim, the founder of Gojek, actually graduated from Harvard Business School.
Yeah.
not from Babson, but he's the real entrepreneur. Mm-hmm. So sometimes you cannot educate a person to become entrepreneur, entrepreneur by giving them a specific entrepreneurial curriculum. What is your?
Yeah, in fact, Peter Drucker. I know, you know, Peter Drucker, the godfather of entrepreneurship, has a definition for entrepreneur. He said that entrepreneur sees the challenges and the problem as opportunity. So if you live in your life, whatever challenges and difficulty and barriers and the problem you face it, if you have entrepreneurial mind, you will find an opportunity to make it as a business. So Anita done exactly that she created a thing from nothing.
Sir, please.
Before that, we would like to welcome Mr. Sandiaga Uno.
Oh, Pak
Let's
Sandiaga
give a round of applause
Uno.
Of welcome.
Selamat datang.
Thank you so much for joining us. Thank you. Please be seated and let's continue. Thank you, Mr. Moderator.
Yes.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. This is El-Sayed Hani. I am a journalist from Egypt. I follow the most discussions here talk about how we can make money available for small and medium business. But in my opinion, I think that the main challenge for small and medium business is marketing. If we can help them to marketing, I think it's important as we can make money available for them. Thank you.
You make me happy, sir, because I'm a marketing guy. So one day, I invited my minister. I'm a special advisor to the Minister of Cooperative and Small Medium Enterprise in my event in Solo. And I invited also the son of the president, Gibran Jokowi, who is an entrepreneur. Okay. And then I invited 10 best small medium enterprise from Solo. Solo is the small city where our president is coming from. And then I asked all the 10 small entrepreneurs, medium enterprise entrepreneurs, to share the business. And then after that, I asked Gibran, the son of Jokowi, one question only. Mas Gibran, what can we improve these 10 best SME entrepreneurs from Solo? Only one, Pak, marketing. That's why I'm very happy. Okay, welcome, Pak Sandiaga Uno.
Thank you, Pak.
So, Sandiaga Uno is one of the Indonesia's most prominent young entrepreneurs. He's very famous, yeah, and is active in the Indonesian business community. He's the co-founder of PT Saratoga Investama Sedaya TBK and served as a president director 2004-2015. He has led the investment firm to have a solid track record of profitable investment across key sectors of Indonesia economy. Sandiaga is a chairman of Indonesia Association of Traditional Market Merchant, chairman of Indonesia Swimming Federation, vice chairman of the Micro, Small and Medium Enterprises Cooperative and Creative Economy of Indonesian Chamber of Commerce and Industry, Kadin Indonesia, vice chairman of Indonesia Public Listed Company Association. He served as chairman of Indonesia Forum Foundation 2013 to 2015, Indonesian Economic Committee as a member of 2010 to 2014, and the chairman of Indonesian Young Entrepreneurs Association 2005-2008. Sandiaga holds a Bachelor of Business Administration summa cum laude from Wichita State University and an MBA from George Washington University. He is married with 3 children. There are 2 things that missing here, Pak Sandiaga.
Yeah, Pak.
Number one, you don't mention that you are a marathoner.
I know.
He is a marathoner. Yeah? He can run for 42 kilometers easily, yeah? But for charity, yeah? For charity. Number two, this is very important. He is an official candidate for the governor of Jakarta, yeah? this is very important, yeah? Okay, Pak Sandiaga, so the 2 panelists already share their opinion, 3 minutes. Every panelist given 3 minutes about how we are going to upgrade Indonesian micro business in market access and funding. Please.
Thank you, and sorry for for being tremendously late, Pak Hermawan and distinguished panel. I actually left my car and started running from Semanggi to here because traffic is so horrendous, and that's why you need a new governor for Jakarta in 2017. Anyway,
entrepreneur, you use all opportunities.
I'm a
marketing, right? Marketing.
My DNA is still an entrepreneur, through in and throughout. I guess from the micro, small, medium enterprises framework, the new concept that we are focusing now, and this is thanks to my colleagues at Kadin, Ibu Dewi Huta Barat, Pak Bari here, is what is really ingrained within the culture and core values of Indonesia, which is what we call gotong royong, which is the terms is social solidarity economy, whereby this micro, small, medium enterprises can use their, it's, by the way, it's 57 million of micro, small, medium enterprises across Indonesia. They can use whatever the solidarity economy platform to enhance through marketing, supply chain. Also, we would like to see how this micro, small, medium enterprises can access better capital, also access to technology, because we believe that technology is the game changer. Technology would really transform this micro, small, medium enterprises mm-hmm. to the next level. And I believe Indonesia is a huge market. So in the solidarity supply chain, what we term gotong royong, the growing power of productivity and ability to fulfill market needs will bring prosperity to the many micro, small, medium enterprises. And don't forget, cooperatives. We have a strong core of excellence in cooperatives. We have really not really utilized it and optimized it, but we think this will tackle the job creation. Indonesia is growing rapidly, the economy, but we still have many people not have good access to jobs. We also can tackle urbanization issues. As McKinsey said, close to 75% of the populations will be in urban areas. That would leave the rural areas pretty much very not growing in terms of their economy. And I think the key issue will be on health, education, and social welfare. So with this, I would like to end my presentations that the social solidarity economy, or economy gotong royong, will encourage us to form an innovative partnership among countries in the regions and globally. And I think the key here is the micro, small, medium enterprises as assets, not liability for our country to grow together. And actually, Pak Hermawan, this is the second time WIEF, Tun Musa, hosted here. The last time I participated here in Jakarta is 2009. And I think the event is now really, really transformed and arranged more professionally. So I congratulate the World Islamic Economic Forum. We hope that this will be the next up to par with Davos very soon.
Okay. Okay, Pak Sandi. So one issue that we discussed earlier before you came is entrepreneur is made of bone. I know you are a born entrepreneur. You have the DNA, very strong DNA of entrepreneurship, right? But what is your opinion? Yeah? Born or made?
Made.
Because some people think that we can educate. Yeah. So made, why?
Made, because we, at our very deep down inside our core beliefs, every single man and woman is an entrepreneur, and they because entrepreneurship is a mindset, it's not a profession. Entrepreneurship is basically your mindset in terms of providing solutions to the problem that you're having, being innovative, and never ever underestimate somebody whose back is against the wall. They become very entrepreneurial. I started my business from basically zero. It was 97, 98, almost 20 years ago, when we had a big economic crisis in Asia and actually a multi-dimensional crisis in Indonesia that leads to the reform period. At that time, cars were burning on the street. Economy was minus 14%. People were rioting. I started my business through adversity. Nobody would even give me a chance. Truly an underdog story. So I said that I was not trained as an entrepreneur. My dad works for an oil company for 30 years. My mom is a teacher. So when you're presented with adversity, you could strive for the best. And that's really ingrained in every single human being to become an entrepreneur. They can have an entrepreneurial mindset. I guess that's how we should really pretty much take it and learn what we have inside and shape it and recognize that you have the potential, you have the power. So I believe that everyone is an entrepreneur. You just have to recognize it, train it, find a mentor, and hopefully sometimes become a very successful person.
Okay, there are so many definitions about entrepreneurship. I have my personal definition. Number one, entrepreneurs can see the opportunity, not the threat. With the same reality, with the same fact, an entrepreneur always see the opportunities, opportunity side, and the professional, if you want to contrast entrepreneur with professional. They see only threat. Number two, after seeing the opportunity, they want to take risk. They dare to take calculated risk taking, not risk avoider. Number three, after seeing the opportunity, taking risk calculatively for sure, so we are ready to collaborate with any other people, right? We don't do it by ourselves. So entrepreneurs is luar biasa, it's extraordinary actually. So that's why you want to take risk to go to politic also. Do you think going to politic is one of your realization of the your entrepreneurship?
Yeah. I think before Sandy? I answer that, my colleague would like to say something.
No, I'm sorry. I have an interpretation. I have a reply for that. In fact, there is a recent research, very interesting, showing that during first, Jean-Peter mentioned that 300 years back, we didn't have a paid job. So up to 300 years back, our ancestors were working as entrepreneurs. About the last 200, 250 years, we start to have an employed scheme. But coming to our colleague, in fact, the research showing that we have a three generation of entrepreneurs. We have the entrepreneurs of the Industrial Revolution, where people are just making money. They have the slave and the production and the money. The second generation, which is started by the early last century, the four, the people who are inventing most of what you are leaving, Edison and that, it was the second generation where people start to make little money and more well-being for the human being. Yeah. And we have our colleague from the third generation who started in late 80s, who are social entrepreneurs, who are willing to make money, but to help the community, to solve a problem. So actually, if we look to our colleague, we have in our community education problem, health problem, we have welfare problem, we have marketing money, okay. But overall, we have a political. So he has an opportunity to go for political, which I mean he's materializing the third generation of
Yeah, community. I will go back to Pak Sandi later. But James, any comment? Give time to Pak Sandi to draft the answer, right? Is your political track now is part of your strong entrepreneurial spirit or not? But James,
I say hat off to you for that, and I think on that side it's interesting to mix that the business and politics element, because usually it's one or the other, and serving the people, but looking to serve the people in a very different way, I think can only be very inspirational, to say the least.
Okay, Pak Sandi.
Thanks, Pak Hermawan. What I said is entrepreneurship is a mindset. So my DNA is an entrepreneur. Whether I'm an entrepreneurial politician or a political entrepreneur, that remains to be seen. But I believe that it starts and ends with people. When I was an entrepreneur, business entrepreneur, there's always, I'm always dealing with numbers, financial statements, reports, forecasts, guiding the investors. But at the end of the day, there are people behind numbers. And it's how many people that we have touched in whatever we do. Being an entrepreneur, I am at least touching about 50,000 people who are working within our organizations and their families and our customers, as well as investors and many other people who have stakes or stakeholders within our business. But now that I'm moving into politics, and that's truly, I didn't have a grand design. It was just basically a calling that one of the political parties said that, do you want to have bigger impact in what you do and try to fix the country and start contributing to the country? Politics would be a much better place for you to get better, bigger impact, because you're dealing with, on micro, small, medium enterprises, at least 57 million. If you have the right policies and if you have a good sets of execution skills, you could be changing the lives of 57 million people. Mm-hmm. So I made that move understanding that, yes, there will be a naysayer saying that I'm an opportunist, I'm just looking for a higher office. But you know, when you're set to do something, you sort of like focus. Don't start getting disoriented with social media attacking you. The netizens here, I don't know whether you follow Indonesia, it's the capital for Twitter and Facebook. They're very, very noisy, and they're very, as Hermawan would know, very critical in what you do. So I set it aside. I said that I'm doing this for the people of Indonesia.
Wow.
And let's see in 5 years whether I made the right decisions or not.
Wow. Wow. So, you know, in the last 18 years, I've been co-authoring 5 books with Professor Philip Kotler, the father of modern marketing, and my latest book is what I call Marketing 3.0, inspired by Prophet Muhammad, actually. Doing business with honesty and everything, because with internet technology, you must be honest, right? Mm-hmm. Back to basic now. And in Seoul, in New York, last month, in ICSB event, I presented my model about entrepreneurship 3.0 now. Yeah. Entrepreneurship 1.0, like marketing 1.0, we focus on the product. We focus on ourselves. How to create profit, like Marco Polo. You know the story of Marco Polo from Italy. He took risk to go to China, and then becoming very rich. That is product-centric and for the entrepreneur itself. But entrepreneur 2.0 is like marketing 2.0, customer-centric. This is, I took the example of Henry Ford. Henry Ford with whatever color you choose, as long as it is black, it's okay. So the employee can buy the car, can afford to buy the car. So you only don't only make profit, but your employee, like Pak Sandiaga Uno. But 3.0 is what I call entrepreneurship for humanity. And marketing 3.0 is about human-centric, from product to customer to human-centric. The case that I took as an example in Seoul and New York is Samsung. Because I went to the museum of Samsung, wow, the technology is for humanity. Yeah. And now you are entering 3.0, but Enterprise 3.0.
Yes.
Yeah? Because you want to be a politician to give a bigger impact for humanity, right?
That's right.
Okay, thank you. Big hand to Pak Sandiaga Uno. Okay, we still have 5 minutes. Time?
Question? There is a...
Yeah, Bapak? Sir? Please?
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam.
So thanks for the opportunity and awesome discussion. So my name is Arif. I am a chief everything officer.
Chief
everything officer.
Yeah, chief everything officer.
CEO, yeah?
Chief
everything officer.
Yeah, sure.
I have CMO, not chief marketing officer, chief million senior officer. Okay.
Of Amplified. So Amplified itself is a private incubator. So we create a tech startup in Indonesia. So maybe a little bit story about Amplified. We create Labaik. It's a private guidance for pilgrims who want to go Umrah to Mecca and Medina. So we created, and soon we will create a Labaik e-commerce. So we sell dates or kurma and our zamzam online. So before we go to Mecca and Medina, so they can buy it the first.
So?
This. So my question, first question is, how to increase the awareness of the local conglomerates, sort of like local venture capitals or private equity or something? Because in my perspective, nowadays, the current situation of the startups is very easy to get funding, but the funding is coming from outside Indonesia, right? Especially for the early stage startup and seed funding. I think the local awareness of the local conglomerate is still low about this sectors okay. of the technology because it's bleeding okay. in early stage.
Number one. Number two?
Number two is regarding to Mrs. The first question. After the entrepreneur gave or get funding, maybe in the startup scene, we need a startup coach to keep the fund is used well. Also to keep the startup mentality, they will go ups and downs.
Yeah,
so
they need coach lah.
Yeah, coaching. Coach.
Yeah. Number three, still left?
That's not two.
Okay.
All right, thank you. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Waalaikumsalam.
You, James?
Just to touch upon that, and as my colleagues mentioned, mentoring is really, really important. To find those people that can help take you through that, so you're not doing the thing alone. But going back to the funding is easy, but from outside, I think it starts with the startup community. In Denmark, we did a community by the entrepreneurs, for entrepreneurs. It wasn't a top-down approach, it was a bottom-up approach that meant that we got the recognition from okay. the corporations and the other organizations yeah. as a community together as entrepreneurs. Maybe that's something that should start, and that's how you'll start getting that recognition from the others yeah. within the nation.
Atef?
Yeah, I mean, I have just an example, concrete, that in Bahrain, about 10 years back, we didn't have microfinance, which is destined for digital or for innovative or for creative. We have that classical microfinance. And I was a GM in a Bahrain Development Bank, and we had plenty of people are coming, and we are refusing them due to the problem of collateral, due to the amount of money which you don't have. So we have the idea at that time that why we don't create a bank which is destined for that. So we just proposed the idea just for our colleague as a political idea, that we propose the idea for five banks, that we create a social bank, which is a trust bank. So the paid up capital comes from five banks, and the government was very interested because it's a public, so it was semi-public, 60% owned by the private, 40% by the government, and we licensed by the Central Bank of Bahrain. So, I mean, if you are innovative, the problem is not the money, the problem, even the partnership needs innovation. For the question of venture capital, as my colleague mentioned, you have to create a society association, you have to create okay. a lobbying group who are getting yeah. down to the yeah. bottom line and collecting the money, yeah. A small amount of money. I mean, you don't have to link a crowdfunding as a model. You can have your own venture capital or crowdfunding, and we have plenty of people who are worldwide yeah. are creating even local
okay.
crowdfunding.
But Sandy, 1 minute, probably.
Mentorship. Very, very important. Not just coaching, but really living within the ecosystem. I was extremely lucky to have met my mentor, Pak William Suryajaya, the late Pak William Suryajaya. May he rest in peace. Where he was just basically spending time, like 1 hour every Saturday to have lunch with him. You could really see the passion, the value, and really the respect and honor of becoming an entrepreneur. So find your mentor, find a good one, and now you don't really have to physically be with him because we have social media, so good luck in building your business at Amplified.
Okay, time is up. So thank you to all three panelists. Give big hand to James, Atef, and Pak Sandi. Good luck, Pak Sandi, for your governorship.
Thank you, Pak. And really need good marketing because I'm trailing by a lot. So with Pak Hermawan's marketing. I hope I can catch up very soon.
Thank you very much.